Before I start, to get an idea about the audience here, who knows Swagger and OpenAPI version 3 already? Oh, not so many. Okay. Then it's good. I will make a short introduction later on. First, a few words about me. As Sam already said something, I just wanted to add that during this project that I made in 15 years in distributed environments, I always work on somehow among with APIs, and good APIs are really a key for success, and that's why I always focused on during my previous work. I worked in telecommunications business first and then moved over to energy and finance business, but the problem itself doesn't really change. You have a higher count of APIs involved per use case, and so you need to take care of those APIs. So, as Sam already said, I'm also contributing to open source projects at Apache, mainly for the CXF project, and I will show you some demo with CXF later on. Yeah, in the keynote, Paul already focused on APIs and the boundaries. For me, APIs are the glue between applications. So when I started with this SOA stuff years ago, everyone was happy to have whistles for the APIs because it was described and you have a contract and everyone was fine with it until this resource orientation with REST came up. And yeah, then it was difficult because whistle is not resource oriented, and whistle 2.0 was built, but nobody used it. And Waddle was a submission to W3 to address those issues. So Waddle was resource oriented, but still has its blown up XML structure, and nobody was happy with it, and it never made it to a final specification. And that's why Swagger was born. There was Tony Tam, a guy working for Wordnik, which is a dictionary in the US, and he said, well, just a couple of URLs that I sent over to someone is not enough as an API description. I need more. And he looked, what can I use? And he invented this Swagger to describe those APIs. So, and there was a fast-growing fan community. The project was on GitHub, and the forks and stars went up, and that's why Smart Bear came into place and said, well, there's success, let's buy it. And everyone was afraid and said, well, what's now going on with this open source project? Can we keep it like that? You may know Smart Bear. It became famous by SOAP UI. It's a tool that we use in this SOA area to do testing for this SOAP interfaces and all this XML stuff with whistle that I mentioned before. And it's now also used for REST-based testing. But they noticed, well, it's better to keep this open process. And there was a formation of the OpenAPI initiative under the umbrella of the Linux Foundation, where they donated the Swagger stuff that they bought to keep the open process, be vendor neutral. And all major companies joined those OpenAPI initiatives. There's Google, Microsoft, and even WSO2. And within that process, Swagger was renamed to Swagger's a really handy name, and everyone is using it. But it was renamed to OpenAPI specification. So you somehow need to differentiate between Swagger and OpenAPI specification. Swagger is still a trademark of Smart Bear and used for the tooling they build around it. But the specification itself is now named OpenAPI specification. So when you describe an API, you do it with the OpenAPI specification. And the further spec development still happens on GitHub. So you can go there and file a pull request if you don't agree with some stuff that's in the specification. The new major version, 3.0.0, came out after 1.5 years of development. And then it was followed by patch releases in December and October this year. So to show you some differences, for those of you who do not know the spec itself, it's a JSON or YAML document structured in several sections. And this one here on the left is the old Swagger 2.0 version. And the one on the right-hand side is the new Open API 3.0. And as you can see, this one evolved, and there was stuff added. And we need this one. Let's add it here. So it's not as clear as the new structure on the right-hand side. But if you already have specifications that are in Swagger 2.0, you can simply drop in 3.0, and everything is working out of the box. So there's incompatibility, as you see. Those one here, definitions, parameters, responses, are now aggregated in components, security definitions as well. And the host sections, there was in the past only one host. Now you can define multiple hosts, for example, for a testing staging environment, some sandbox environment, or something like that. So if you have 2.0 specifications, you need to migrate them. This can be done automatically using JSON transformation, but it's you basically, when you are a tool vendor, you need two different implementations to support it. And that's why it was published in July 2017, but still the tool vendors are working on adapting the changes and making their tools compatible. Whoops. So I'd like now to show you some more details about the new stuff that's in there. Definitions, responses, parameters, and response headers, and security definitions is not really something new. That was also part of the old specification. It's just aggregated in this component sections to have all reusable elements in one place. What's new is callbacks and links. I'll show it later in more detail. The most important thing that you will heavily use is path item, where you describe your resources, which means when you have customers and a customer resource, you will describe this as a path item. And then typical operations, for example, will be CRUD, create, read, update, delete. You have a post operation and a get operation and a delete operation, for example. And in the old version, you could describe that operations on operation level, which means when you have somehow description for the customer, you need to copy and paste it to each operation. And now with the new version, you can make this description on the path item itself. So you have it really on path level. And one of the best improvements that I strongly suggest to make use of it is the examples section for responses and requests. Because when you describe an API, you can define the syntax, and you can validate it. But the consumer never knows a real good idea of what you meant with this operation until you show him a sample request, how you really want to have it used. So that's syntax versus semantics on the other side. Yes, as I said, here are the callbacks. In the past, there was always request response, which means synchronous call. You call the API and there's a response, and that was also the definition that was part of the Swagger 2.0. And with the new version 3, you can specify a callback, which means somehow a publish subscribe operation as used for webhooks, for example. So you call the API, and then there's a callback later on to do it asynchronously. So you put in the path item where the callback should trigger the response. So what's not covered? Alternative schemas like gRPC were in discussion but didn't make it into the version 3. So if you want to use it, you need to find something else or build a wrapper around that. Unfortunately, maybe it will be added in future version, not clear yet. There is some fork named Async API specification, which you can use for IoT scenarios like MQTT or MQP. It's based or influenced by the Open API specification, but it's not a sister project that's developed concurrently. It has another user base. So now to get a bit more practical, what do I have to do when I want to develop an API using open API specification? As I said, there's Swagger tooling, an open source project driven by SmartBear. It consists out of four components. You have a core library that's used by all other components. You have a UI to visualize the API, and you can make test calls with it. You have a code generator, Swagger code gen, and an editor. Why do we need a code generator? When developing APIs, you have two options. You can start API or contract first, which means you first describe the API, you write the specification, specify the items that are part of the API itself. And then you generate your code from that API description. And the other way around is code first. You start building code, create a working application, and then the API description is generated out of the code. Currently, API first trend, I would say. So everyone suggests to do it API first. I also suggest to do it that way because you really have a contract that you can fix with your consumers. You can discuss about the contract before you even start with the development. But the demo that I show you is done code first because I'm lazy and we don't have much time in this half an hour. And that's what you will also notice when you discuss with your developers. They don't want to use this editor and write the stuff itself. They want to write code. So that's the discussion that you have to do. What other tools are available? There's the micro profile specification. Those of you who are working with Java know there was this Java EE spec discussion with Oracle, and before it moved to the Eclipse Foundation as Jakarta EE, there was a spin-off with this lightweight specification process called MicroProfile, and they built an API that is supported by Open Liberty, powered by IBM, and Wildfly Swarm with a new name Thorntail, powered by JBoss and Red Hat, and now bought by IBM, so you never know how the project goes. But MicroProfile Open API is basically a standardized version of the annotations that are part of the Swagger framework itself. It's just that they say, well, it's vendor neutral, and we want to support it in different products. And there's Apache CXF. I'm a bit biased as I'm a contributor, but we currently use this Swagger annotations, and we already have an implementation in Apache Geronimo, which is a sister project, which is using MicroProfile API, and we plan to integrate it also there, so then you have the free choice. And what I learned here at the conference yesterday, there's Ballerina. Tomorrow there's Ballerina Day, and Ballerina also has the opportunity to work with Open API specification. I don't know much about that yet, so I'm looking forward to tomorrow. But it's really interesting. So now I'd like to show you some live demo how to create an API using CXF. That's fairly easy. Just need to wake up here. And then how to do it with WSO2 API Manager. So can we switch? Yes, great. So basically, what to do? Let me see if I can. So as I said, this is a code-first approach, and I'm showing you an official Swagger sample. They have a pet store where you can somehow administer pets. And here's a CRUD operation where you can find pets by ID. And what we see here is Java code, but when you do it in other programming languages, it's basically the same. You have annotations where you specify the stuff for the specification, and you have your programming code. And here's a mix out of Spring annotations and JuxRS annotations and Swagger annotations. Basically, the stuff where you need the Swagger annotations is the other parts that are not covered by all the other annotations that are in there. So parse, for example, is a JuxRS annotation, and this will be used by the Swagger framework, so no need to duplicate that. But the description, for example, it's not possible to have it in some other annotation, so they build an own annotation for it. And then you have a summary and a tag and a description for the response itself and the response codes. And here on top, there's some meta information for the whole API where you describe a title, a version, and a description. So that's pretty easy. And we can now, wait a second. We can now run that. And this is Spring Boot for those of you who haven't heard of it. It's really a framework that avoids boilerplate code. So you basically, in that project, you just have this class and some start class, no other configuration, and then it boots up in seconds. And we can then access the API using the Swagger UI. It is integrated in that process, so local development is fairly easy, and your API resources are visualized really nicely. So when I talk to some product manager, for example, and I want to explain him what's in that API, I always use this. The problem is when we went to production with some APIs, he asked me, well, I need to see this colored stuff. No, you don't need to. The API is working under the hood. But this is really the thing that's in mind when the people see it for the first time. So, and what you can do here is also test the API, so you can execute it, and then you see here request and response. So, next step is to integrate this API, so I can also use it here. And then I have the JSON format, so I have to run the, I have a WSO2 API manager installed locally, where we will now put it. Thanks to Tristan, who already introduced publisher and store, so no need to tell that again. So needs some time to boot up. It's a demo effect. Well, basically, I'm looking forward to this new micro gateway to be a bit more lightweight, because there's so much stuff that came into WSO2 API Manager over the time. So that is, it's really powerful, but also some kind of heavy. So finally, there it is. Ah, there it is. So let's try it again. I first thought I should use some cloud instance, but I wasn't unsure if the Wi-Fi is really reliable. So there's a self-signed certificate, so there's a login. And if you want to add those API, let me first delete the old one. You simply click Add New API, tell you have an existing one. You can do it by URL or by file. I just saved it to file. Then you take the spec JSON that I just saved to my desktop, put it in there. And it doesn't work. Woo. Why is it that way? I know it. I just wanted to tell you why it is that way. I installed the latest OpenAPI, the latest WSO2 API Manager version. But as I said, there are newer versions of the spec, and CXF and the Swagger framework already support the next minor one. There's no real change, but to have it working with WSO2 API Manager with the latest version, you need to set it back to 3.0.0, because there's some check in there that's probably removed with the next release. And then you can start creating. Everything is pre-filled except the path that you want to have in there. You have the version that I specified earlier in my annotation here in the code. And you see the operations in a similar way as you saw them in the Swagger UI. So then I can save it, just say where this stuff is running. In my case, it's localhost. selected here and save and publish. So, and then my API is in there. So what I'm now want to show you next is it a good idea to do this manually when you have we heard of projects where there are 3,000 of microservices and APIs. I don't suggest to build such kind of architecture, but even when you have 100 of APIs, it's not a good idea to do it that way. You should automate this. So let's do it again, delete it. So you see it's now empty. There's no API in there. This is my API document that I exported earlier. And I now want to insert it using an API of the WSO2 API manager. Basically, there's some endpoint where you can push your APIs to. So when you have a continuous integration pipeline, where the deployment of the API is in the end, you can push it directly from your CI tool, for example, Jenkins or GitLab CI. You can push it directly to the WSO2 API manager. So to do it, you need a token first, and you need to register once. I already did that before. So I just get a fresh token from the token endpoint, copy it, put it to my test request. So this is using Postman here, but you you will probably use some other tool in your CI pipeline. So then you take that JSON format of the OpenAPI specification that you defined earlier. You need to replace the quotation marks because you put JSON in JSON, otherwise it will not work. And what you also need to do is you need to join the lines, otherwise you will get trouble. So then you have your JSON format. You put it in here. Looks a bit weird, but when you have automated, you will not see something from it. And then you send it. Hopefully, we get success. So let's have a look if it's there. And there it is, automated. And then you can modify and define further attributes. But the general process from developing those APIs until you update them is automated in this way. Can we switch back to the slides, please? So here again, here's some sample from the Jenkins documentation when you define such kind of pipeline. So you have the checkout, build, test, deploy. And within that deploy step, you will integrate some step to publish this API description to the API manager. So when you add new operations or new versions, it will automatically go through there. So my time is running up. So this is the same sample, basically, when you see the slides later on. I did it using Postman, but you can also do it using curl or the tool of your choice. So conclusion in the end, Swagger is a de facto standard. It's a part of WSO2 API manager for years now, and it's widely used in REST-based applications. So when you want to define API description, Swagger is used for that. There's RAML and other stuff, but the most of the people are using Swagger, and there's extensive tool support. And OpenAPI version 3 is the recent cleanup of that. So all famous vendors are part of the initiative, and that's why it will replace the Swagger 2.0 stuff. So when you now start developing, I suggest to go for OpenAPI version 3. And as I showed you, it's 3.0.0 is already supported in WSO2 API Manager. Yeah, thanks for having me. I think is there time for questions? I think not, but I'll be around after that, so just approach me and we can discuss about that. Thank you.